Welcome to Rotary Program Balahdan, the show that brings activism and the immigrant community. I know the growing immigrant community here in the Twin City in Minnesota are together, and we have the Somali community. We have representative from the Somali communities. We have Keith Allison from the African American Muslim community, and we have the head of the nation as African American. So minority and immigrants are really making a stride in our political system. We have here a very special guest, Representative Susan Allen. She is the first American Indian woman in our people house here, representative here in Minnesota, and she also in the district 62B, and I'm sure 62B, that's a lot of minority live in that that district. Welcome to Balahdan, Representative Susan.
I
know we have a lot of firsts. We like to say the first, right, Keith Allison, the first Muslim, first. But what does that mean? The first American Indian woman, so mm-hmm. American Indian and woman in our state representative. How significant that is to your community, to your people, and also to the immigrants at large.
Right.
You're not an immigrant, so I'm just not a comparison. You are the native, but also
indigenous.
Yes. Okay.
It was very important, and it was it made national news. I mean, we're small. We're less than 1% of the population nationwide. So, and there's about 300 and some tribes, but we're a small people. So, and we have our own like media, and so it was. It got attention, and so the first. I'm not the first American Indian person to serve in the House. There were about, I'm not sure, I think about maybe five men.
But first woman.
First woman.
But when you grow up in your indigenous native community, and you see the issue they are facing every day, and you broke away and you went to came to the city and you went to law school and all that, mm-hmm. Was it tough to make that decision to break away and decided I'm gonna get into this
area
yeah. white system here and I'm trying to make a change. And sometimes it's hard. Mm-hmm. The struggle: should I be staying with my people to help them, or should I go into the system and try to help them from there?
Mm-hmm. Well, I grew up in a lot of urban areas and throughout the country, so we moved around a lot. So I was from an Episcopal priest, so we were from Pine Ridge.
I see.
So the fact that he left was pretty amazing, and he lived to be 75 years old, where in that reservation, still the average life expectancy for men is 45 years old. So for him to get educated and decide to leave, that was significant.
How you're local? How you're
how did I get here?
Yeah, no, I mean, I hate to say your people. It's like, mm-hmm. how do they look at you, someone like you, that he breaks away and go to, other school? What do you look at it, white school or established school, mm-hmm. law school? How do they look at that?
Well, I think of it as integration. We're doctors, lawyers, teachers, and so I think that education was something in my family that was an opportunity that I saw because of my father, mm-hmm. and so he was the first in his family to graduate from college, and mm-hmm. then I became the second, and I have like 30 some first cousins that live in the Pine Ridge Reservation. I think the only one that graduated from college. And I think growing up, though, you become very politically aware, mm-hmm. because of at the time when I was growing up in the late 60s, 70s is when the AIM, American Indian Movement, was founded.
Yeah.
And so the takeover of Wounded Knee, the Alcatraz, and the takeover of the BIA building in D.C. And so those were very... I knew some of the people there, and my father
activism
was someone involved.
And political,
yes, and so right. that, so I had my roots are there in uh-huh. that activism, and so to be to use education or to organize or to to be involved in the community was something that I grew up. That's how I grew up. So.
And the fact you grow up in that era, and I don't want to say this radicalism, but this is the era of activism mm-hmm. in the United States at large, in African Americans, Native Americans, and all that. And I know you when you go to the state representative and you stand with all this everybody else there, and you take the pledge,
or the Pledge of Allegiance,
and
which I had to learn.
I have to learn. And how did you do it? You know, I know Keith Ellison, when he was taking that the first time was elected, went to the Congress, he put her hand on the Quran, mm-hmm. the Muslim holy book. In yours, you have a belief system, or do you believe in our system, and you do it like everybody else?
Well, I think of it as having, as an American Indian, as having dual citizenship, uh-huh. and so I'm a tribal member, and in our system, in our federal system, tribal membership is a political status. Mm. It's not a racial classification. So that's how Indian people have a unique status in this country, is because of the sovereignty retained, and so it's a political. So then when there's laws, if you look at the U.S. Code, Title 25, I mean, it's the reason those laws aren't unconstitutional is because it's not based on race, it's based on political status.
I see.
And so then I'm also a member of my community and a state and a citizen of this country and the state. And so I look at it as that I'm a part of both.
That's like the first time you walk into the house.
I didn't even know where it was. I mean, I knew that I had seen it driving by, but I'd never
all
been
the
there
people
before.
Who do you do protest or demonstration know where it is.
Yeah,
I mean, what would you go there for?
Right, outside. So I'd never been in there. The whole system. I mean, I was somewhat familiar from school and civics and
field trips.
Right, but the whole it's a whole sort of a different world. I mean, I had mm-hmm. somebody tell me that there's no way to describe it, and if you tried to tell you, there's not going to be anything like that. And so it is a whole different institution that is it's very formal and mm-hmm. in a lot of ways. And then if you look at the makeup, there's 134 representatives, and three of us are minority out of 134.
Wow! So my goodness.
There's a Latino, Mariano, and then Rena Moran, African-American.
This is the White House.
Yes.
So they show you the bathroom, they show you the room.
Well, it's hard to get around there. So the first time that you have a legislative assistant, and she pretty much escorted me through all the tunnels and all that to get to where I needed to be in committee rooms.
I see, yeah. So. And by the time you figure out the logistic part mm-hmm. of the house or building, now you have to think about bills and what's your area? And I know you represent a certain issue. What's your issue?
Well, I represent South Minneapolis, so uh-huh. and that is the Powderhorn, Bryant, and mm-hmm. Central neighborhoods.
I see.
So it's over 40% minority, and so you have African immigrants, and then a large growing Latino population, and then you call them racially, what do they call them, areas, culture, what is it called, racially?
So politically correct name for that.
No, I mean the areas where they have highest uh-huh. individuals living in poverty.
Uh-huh.
And
oh,
so
really?
There are three areas in the district I represent that are, that have pockets where minority that are living in poverty, and mm-hmm. so it's about like 40% of the children in those areas are living in poverty. So the area that I spend most time dealing with is Health and Human Services. So mm-hmm. I'm on the Health and Human Services Policy and Finance Committee.
Do you choose the issue you have to deal with, like health or? Foreigner or mm-hmm. whatever, it's your call?
No, you can, there
committee.
I don't forget how many committees there are, but you would put your preference, you'd say, rank them 1 through 5, and then the leadership chooses. So, but they usually try to,
accommodate
them. Yeah, accommodate what your interests are, so what your concerns.
In your area too, I mean, in that district, also a lot of gay and lesbian, mm-hmm. and you also proudly an open gay person, mm-hmm. and a woman, indigenous, Native Americans, And gay, this is what we call Michelle Bachmann nightmare.
Yeah.
Have you ever met Michelle Bachmann?
No. But there was a story initially sort of comparing me to her that we actually came from the same congressional district there, the same area.
You went to school?
No, we came from the same area. So that how could a state produce two of us extreme opposite?
Stop for a few seconds, take a break, and then we'll come back. And
in
the meantime, this is election in Egypt. Talk about election here. And Marshal Sisi, after people say revolution or coup of June series, eventually he is now running, the front runner of presidential election. All the hoopla for the last year about how magnificent Marshal Sisi, the one who is going to save Egypt from the Brotherhood and extremism and terrorism. He's the Bush of Egypt. It turned out the election has very few voters and a lot of talks about the empty election polls, stations. And it was a major blunder there, and they had to extend the days, one more day and one more day, and issue a warning: if you don't vote, we're gonna fine you $500 and Egyptian pound, and people walking in the street that have like drive-through voting, where people go to the cars and people in the street and give them a ballot. It's a bizarre election, but hopefully it's over, and hopefully the CC will take over. And so I talked to a few eyewitnesses from Cairo, Egypt, about the election and how they feel about it, and we'll show you that clip, and then we'll come back to the studio. Assalamu alaikum, and God bless you all.
تقريبا 70% من الشعب بينزل يصوت بيستجيب لدعوة التيارات الإسلامية سواء بسبب الخطاب الديني لأن احنا مجتمع مفترض ان هو مجتمع محافظ ومجتمع متدين او لأن
السيسي والجنرال اللي بيخوض انتخابات محسومة مسبقا والقصة خلصانة. هو أنا شايف تحديدا إن الإشكالية ديت كانت أكتر إشكالية ضرته في اليومين اللي فاتوا مع بداية الاستحقاق للانتخاب اللي حصل في البلد.
السياسية الثانية حركة زي حركة 6 أبريل، حركة جماعة ضغط ليها توجه مدني توجه علماني ومع ذلك مقاطعة بسبب اعتقال قيادتها. مرشحين الرئاسة السابقين على الأقل البارزين منهم زي خالد علي أو بن فتوح. خالد علي معروف ان هو بتوجهه يساري.
للايام نفسها في وسط الاسبوع مش مثلا اول اسبوع او اخر اسبوع ممكن ناس كتير جدا تقدر انها تاخد يوم اجازه ممكن قلت درجات الحراره الناس كتير جدا اتكلموا فيها لدرجه ان احنا النهارده انتظرنا قرار جريء من سعاده الدكتور محلب ان هو يبقى في قرار مجلس الوزراء تخفيض درجه الحراره بكره
طيب انت نفسك رحت انتخبت؟
لا طبعا انا طبعا مقتنع بفكره المقاطعه وفكره المقاطعه بتفقد النظام شرعيته.
طبعا انا ما نزلتش انتخبت لان دي مسرحيه معروف النتيجه بتاعتها. بالنسبه لان انا اخويا معتقل فكل الحاجات بقى الدم والقتل والتفكير بالحاجات اللي حصلت كلها ظاهره قدامي.
ان الجيش اخطا نفس الخطا اللي عمل الاخوان ان هم رشحوا ممثل في الرئاسه.
اعتقد ان السيسي هيخسر تاريخه وحسني مبارك قبل كده خسر تاريخه العسكري وكان من قاده حرب اكتوبر لما قعد في السلطه وما قدرش يحل المشاكل وتورط في الفساد.
المشهد بالنسبه لي ان كان من الافضل ان المشيع فتح السيسي كان ينتهي عند المرحله اللي هو انتهى عليها ونشتغل سياسه او نقدم طرح تاني مختلف.
الناس لو ما كانش الجيش والعسكر اتدخلوا كان ممكن ده كفيل ان محمد مرسي يستجيب للشعب ويدعو لانتخابات مبكره او يتنحى.
طب هو حمدين صباحي هيقدم ايه؟ وايه المشروع اللي عنده اللي هو هيقدمه.
حتى صمتنا بيرعبكم فلنراقب بصمت.
يعني العسكر ما تدخلوش اللي عملوا الاخوان في 80 سنه كانوا يهدموه باخطائهم الجسيمه.
يعني الجيل بتاعي كله وصل للقناعه دي.